In this video I take a look at the structures of the 20 common alpha amino acids. They are typically divided into four categories, namely polar, nonpolar, acidic and basic. So let's begin with the part of the molecule that's common to all 20 amino acids, and this is it. You see that we have an amino group, NH2, and a carboxylic acid group, or carboxyl group, COOH. And that's where amino acids get their name, amino from the amino group and acid from the carboxylic acid group. The 20 different amino acids have a different so-called R group, and here in the case of glycine, our simplest amino acid, the R group is a hydrogen atom, and it's a non-polar amino acid. It's the only amino acid that's not optically active, as the alpha carbon there has two H's attached. On to the second amino acid. And here the R group is now a CH3 group, a methyl group. And again, this is a non-polar amino acid. Remember, there are four categories: non-polar, polar, acidic and basic. The next three amino acids up, starting with this one called valine, fit into a category known as BCAAs, which stands for branched chain amino acids. They are again all non-polar, which makes them hydrophobic. The bottom right, I'll identify whether these are essential or non-essential. This particular one, valine, is an essential amino acid. Our body cannot synthesize this, so it has to be provided in our food. So-called complete proteins are those that contain all the essential amino acids. Here's the second of our BCAAs, leucine. You'll see that it's a chain isomer of the previous one, valine. And again, this is an essential amino acid. And then moving on to the third of our BCAAs, we've got an even longer hydrocarbon chain in our R group. This is it here. And it's called isoleucine. So you can see why these are nonpolar, because these hydrocarbon chains, of course, have lots of dipoles, but the dipoles cancel. And again, isoleucine is an essential amino acid. And our next amino acid is serine. You can see that its functional group includes the OH hydroxyl group, which can form hydrogen bonds with water molecules. So this is an example of a polar amino acid. And these polar amino acids, of course, tend to be found mostly on the outside of the polypeptide chains when they fold to form the secondary and tertiary structures of proteins. Here's threonine, which also has an OH group. And then conversely, of course, you'll tend to find that the nonpolar amino acids are found on the inside of the folded polypeptide chains. And here's aspartic acid. Now, aspartic acid has a second carboxyl group. So while in the previous amino acids we had one basic group and one acidic group which cancelled out, here we have a net acidity because we have a second carboxyl group. And here's our next one, glutamic acid. And like aspartic acid, it has a second carboxyl group, which gives it a net acidity. Moving on to the next one. And this is lysine. Now this is basic because it has a second amino group. So one carboxyl group and two amino groups. So a net basic character. And lysine, you see there, is also an example of an essential amino acid. And moving on to our next amino acid, this is asparagine. And you notice that it has a primary amide as part of its R group. And amides are neutral, of course, but it fits into the polar category. Hydrogen bonds can be formed using the O and the N's of the amide link there. Hydrogen bonds with water, that is. Moving on to the next amino acid, and this one's called glutamine. A bit confusing that, as it has an amide group as part of its R group, but it's polar. And glutamine is the most abundant of the amino acids found in humans, and it's referred to not as essential but as conditionally essential. Conditional in, for example, the fact that perhaps the staple diet in the country happens not to include enough glutamine. Here's our next polar amino acid, cysteine. It's got CH2SH as its R group, and that SH thiol group tends to deprotonate in oxidizing conditions, and that allows us to get this special bond known as a disulfide bond, which do contribute in a significant manner to the structures of certain kinds of proteins. And here's methionine, which also has a sulfur in its structure, but not connected to a H. It's nonpolar, But the lone pairs on the sulfur allow weak interactions between the sulfur and polar species such as metals. And here's proline, which stands out from the other 19 amino acids. You can see that the side chain is actually fused to the rest of the molecule, and as a result, proline confers significant rigidity into the polypeptide chain, whereas glycine, with just a H as its R group, is the opposite. It confers flexibility. And next we have the amino acid arginine. You won't be surprised to see that it's basic, given those three N's as part of the R group. It's found in peanuts, beef, chicken and garlic, for example, and is conditionally essential. Now we've got our aromatic amino acids. These aromatic groups contain delocalized pi electrons, and they'll bond to electron deficient groups, and apparently this helps in particular in what's called scaffolding within protein structure. Here's another one, another aromatic amino acid, this time tyrosine. And it's polar because of the OH group attached to the benzene ring, which allows it to hydrogen bond. And here we have the amino acid tryptophan, which is considered non-polar, and is an example of an essential amino acid again. And then last, but by no means least, we have histidine with this rather strange R group. It has a pKa value of 6 histidine, and apparently it can therefore equally protonate or deprotonate, which makes it good for hydrogen transfer processes in metabolism. And it's an essential amino acid. Also basic because of those nitrogens, which each have a lone pair of electrons, allowing them to accept a proton to behave as a Bronsted base. So that's been my look at the 20 amino acids, all with a different R group. Do note that only L enantiomers are found in most living things, and upon the death of an organism, some of the amino acids will then begin to revert to the other enantiomer, the R enantiomer, as one would expect from entropy considerations. So thanks for listening, and do consider looking at others in the series on amino acids and proteins.